The CBS Radio Mystery Theater presents... seems divided into those needing it and those offering it. But the irony lies in the fact that those offering it so often need it. So the weary world chugs on. One symptom disappears and another takes its place. The breaking of one habit leads to acquiring another. What we all need is one great helper, one outside authority who will tell us precisely what to do and how to do it. If you happen to have the address of this one great helper, I wish you'd pass it on.
Don't touch that.
What's the matter? Why not touch it?
No one is allowed to touch it but myself.
Why? Is it worth a lot of money?
Quite the contrary. It's worth nothing at all.
Our mystery drama, The Outside Girl, was written especially for the Mystery Theater by Elspeth Eric, and stars Paul Hecht. It is sponsored in part by True Value Hardware Stores. I'll be back shortly with Act One. There's almost every sort of help available these days. Having marital troubles? Find a counselor to straighten things out. Having difficulties with your taxes? Consult an accountant. Tormented by depression? Seek out a therapist. Worried about your diet? There are nutritionists who will dissect every morsel on your plate. But another kind of help is almost extinct. Household help. To a certain extent, that is what concerns us in the drama we're about to bring you now.
My name is Charles Arthur Dreyer. Never heard of me? Suppose I said Adrian Conroy Dreyer. Ah, that's a whole different thing, right? Adrian Conroy Dreyer was one of the greats. Probably the greatest portrait painter this country has ever produced. Am I right? You're darn right I'm right. I grew up in the shadow of Adrian Conroy Dreyer, and you want to know something? I'm still crouching in his shadow, his huge, baleful shadow. It's a heck of a way to live, right? And sharing this big old house, which was my father's, with his widow, my mother, doesn't help matters. Quite the contrary.
No. I will not hear of it, Charles.
Is it really asking so much, Mother? After all, it isn't worth anything.
Not to you, maybe, but it is to me.
It's cheap. It's obvious. It's terrible.
Not to me.
It's an eyesore.
It's the most precious thing in my possession. Do you expect me to throw out the most precious thing I own?
Well, if you won't throw it out,
I look at it every day of my life.
Oh, Lord.
I pull that little stool up to the fireplace, the one with the needlepoint that I did myself when your father and I were first married.
Mother,
and I sit
please.
On that little stool, and I look up at that beautiful face, and I talk to it. You didn't know that, did you?
No, I didn't, and I'm sorry you told me.
I don't do it when you're in the house, of course, because you'd make fun of me. I do it when you're at school, teaching your class. I have my hour. That's what I call it, my hour.
Mother, even so...
I don't know how I'd get through the day without my hour. And you want to take it away from me.
No, I don't. It's not
selfish,
that.
selfish.
Just take it down off the wall. That's all I ask.
And put it where, pray tell?
Any place. Any place at all where no one can see it.
In the cellar? In the broom closet? In the downstairs lavatory? Just where would you have me put it?
Mother, there are 9 rooms in this house. There are 4 bedrooms. We only use 2 of them. Surely you could put it in one of those.
I don't want it hanging in some unused room.
Well, why not here in your bedroom?
I mean, then you could look at it all the time if you wanted to.
I don't want it here in my bedroom. I want it in the library over the mantel where it's always hung.
But other people can see it there.
So they can. What of it?
Philip sees it there every time he comes to tea.
Oh, well, you mustn't mind what Philip says.
But I do mind. I mind very much.
Just ignore him.
I can't ignore him because I agree with him. Oh, look, Mother, put it in the studio, why don't you? You could have your hour there.
I don't want it in the studio.
The light's wonderful in the studio. It's much better than...
I want it in the library.
Mother, I'm begging you.
Anyway, the studio is on the third floor, and with my arthritis...
Oh, what you mean is that you really won't take that thing down.
I mean precisely that.
Even when I tell you it's making me miserable.
Oh, you'll get over it.
It's been a whole year, and I'm not over it.
Oh, have patience, dear.
I'll never get over it, as long as I live.
Oh, yes, you will. Answer that when you chant. I don't want to talk to anyone. My head is really quite bad today. And you haven't helped it any with your tantrum.
Yes, hello?
Is Mrs. Dreyer at home?
Yes, she is, but she's not feeling very well. Could I...
One of her headaches.
Who is it?
Yes, as a matter of fact, it is. Who is this, please?
Is this you, Mr. Dreyer?
Who is it?
Yes, it is.
This is Geraldine.
Oh, yes. Mother, it's Geraldine.
Geraldine? What now?
Yes, Geraldine. Is there any message for my mother?
Will you please tell her that I can't come in today?
She can't come in today.
Oh, no, not again.
My mother's not feeling well, and I have to stay with her.
Will she send somebody after Mary? Or Cornelia, or Dorothy, or Jane, or somebody?
Geraldine, my mother says, will you send somebody?
Oh, I'll send somebody, Mr. Dreyer. I've got some cousins over in East Hampton. I can call on from time to time if one of my sisters can't make it.
Yeah, okay, Geraldine.
Tell your mother I hope her head gets better.
Yes, I'll tell her. Thank you. Thank you for calling. She says she hopes your head gets better, Mother. She's sending somebody.
Well, whoever it is, I hope she knows enough to use the back door.
Yes, well, I imagine she will.
Oh, why did Geraldine have to pick today not to show up?
She didn't pick it. Her mother's...
Well, today's the day Philip comes to tea.
Well, call him up and tell him not to come.
Oh, no, I couldn't do that.
You want me to call him?
Your father's dearest friend. Oh, no.
Well, he'll understand.
I will not break with tradition. Philip Hardy has had tea at this house on this day of the week for 29 years. I will not break with tradition.
Oh.
Oh, and you'll have to make the tea.
What?
Unless, of course, the girl Geraldine sending gets here first.
I am not going to make tea. That's your job.
Today, I'm just not up to it. As long as you are under my roof, you will do me these little courtesies, and you will do them graciously. You will make tea, and you will pour it for Philip in the library, as usual. You might even serve some little finger sandwiches.
Oh, Mother.
Now, let's say no more about it. Close the blinds, will you? My head is really throbbing. The library, at least, is presentable. I do a little dusting in there myself every day.
Mother, won't you please reconsider?
The subject is closed. I'm going to take a little nap.
Come in, Philip.
Thank you so much. Rain's still coming now. It's not heavy.
Here, let's have your coat.
It's a bit damp, I'm afraid.
Oh, that's all right. Come in the library.
Delighted, delighted. A hot cup of tea.
There's no tea.
Oh? No tea?
No tea.
But there's always tea.
Not today. After you, Philip.
Hmm? Oh, thank you. Your mother... Always...
My mother is in her room with the shutters closed. One of her headaches.
Oh, I'm so sorry.
And Geraldine phoned and said she couldn't come today. She said she'd send someone, a sister, a cousin, a daughter or something, but so far the girl hasn't showed up.
So, no tea?
Yes, I didn't feel like making it myself. There's a bowl of pretzels, if you'd like one.
Pretzels? Really?
Well, I thought we'd have a drink.
A drink? Well, now...
You do drink, don't you, Philip?
Oh, now and again, but I didn't know you did. Well, I know you did at one time, but I thought... Well, you know, you'd stopped.
I have. I did.
Well, do you think you should start again?
I'll be careful.
It seems to me I remember picking you up in a flop house in Walla Walla, Washington.
Yes, well, that was a year ago.
Right after your father died, yes.
Yes, I haven't had a drink since. What's your pleasure?
A spot of whiskey.
All right. There's your spot.
Oh, many thanks. And that's your spot?
That's mine.
Charles, do you really think... I mean, should you start in again? You know what drinking can do to you.
I drink very rarely. I never did drink regularly.
Yes, but when you do, Charles, when you did...
I've been dry for a whole year.
Well, then why start now?
Because my mother is driving me up the wall.
Already? Is it anything in particular?
You know what it is. That.
Hmm? Oh, that, the painting. Yes.
I know what you think of it. I know what I think of it. It's cold, mechanical, no style, no personality. In short, no talent.
It's a good likeness, Charles.
Is it? Is it really a good likeness?
Well, yes.
The nose is the right length. Is that what you mean? The blue of the eyes is very exact. The skin tones are lively, is that it? The buttons on the coat are precisely indicated.
Now, Charles, my boy.
Does that add up to a man? Does that add up to a human being who lived and loved and suffered? Does that constitute a person who felt, who felt... Whatever it was, he felt.
Do you know what it was he felt, Charles?
No, I don't. I never did. Except contempt for me. He felt that all right.
Oh, Charles.
I don't bother to deny it, Philip. I know he did.
I wasn't going to deny it, then.
Oh, well, I thought you were. Oh, there's the back door buzzer. It must be the maid Geraldine was going to send.
You want a letter in? You want me to...
No. I'll do it.
Maybe I'd better leave. I finished my...
Yes, well, would you mind? I have to show her around.
No, I don't mind the least. You go ahead. I'll let myself out the front.
You know where your coat is?
Yes, I know.
All right. I'm coming. There you
are. Mrs... Oh, wait a minute. I have it written down.
Mrs. Dreyer.
She needs help, right?
Right. Come in. Let me see now. You're not Mary.
Nope.
No. You're not Dorothy, or Jane.
I'm Cassandra.
Oh, well, you can't be Geraldine's sister. You're too young.
I'm not her sister.
No. Of course you're not. You're her daughter.
Nope.
Well, you couldn't be her granddaughter, could you?
Maybe I could, but I'm not.
Are you a cousin?
No, I am an outside girl.
Countless numbers of girls arrive at countless homes to help countless housewives with their work. They do their chores, then they go home. Where that may be, few housewives ever trouble to find out. In truth, how much does any housewife know about any of these girls? Day after day can pass in closest contact and cooperation, yet while the girl may learn a great deal about the lady, years can go by without the lady learning much of anything about the girl. I'll be back shortly with Act Two. Mrs. Dreyer, widow of Adrian Conroy Dreyer, mother of Charles Arthur Dreyer, lies in bed with a sick headache. To increase her discomfort, her accustomed houseworker, Geraldine, has called to say that she cannot come to work. However, she has promised to send a substitute. And as our last act ended, her son Charles opened the back door to a stranger.
Maybe I'd had too much to drink. Or maybe I wasn't used to drinking after being dry for more than a year. But most probably it was my talk with Philip, his observations on the detestable portrait, and the flood of emotion that had welled up in me. Whatever it was, I cannot remember with any real clarity what the girl looked like. She was young, she was small, very small. She was not unattractive. And more than that, I cannot tell you to this very day.
Where do you want me to start?
Any place. Mother's lying down in her room. She has a headache. She could tell you what to do, but I don't like to.
It's all right. Leave her stay where she is. I'll make out.
Yes, well, I'm sure that there are things to clean with. A vacuum cleaner and all sorts of stuff, only I don't know where.
Don't fret. I'll find it.
Yes, well, why don't I show you through the house so you'll see how much there is to do?
They'll be all right.
Oh, now, just this first floor, because I don't think we'll bother today with the upstairs rooms.
On account of your mother?
Well, yes. And it's rather late in the day. I thought you'd be here earlier.
I came as soon as I knew I was needed.
Yes, I'm sure you did. Well, you've seen the kitchen, and through here is the dining room.
Uh-huh.
Yes, my mother likes the mahogany polished every day. I know it's a big job, but...
Not too big. What else?
Well, down this hall, there's the living room. It's fairly large.
I ain't afraid.
you're not afraid of anything, are you?
Nope.
Yeah, well, that's a wonderful way to be. I wonder how many people could say they are not afraid of anything.
Not many, I guess.
Yeah. Well, you're very lucky.
Yes, I am. What's this room here?
This is the library. We don't really have to go in. My mother does a little light dusting in there every day. It probably doesn't need...
We should take a look.
You think so?
I'm positive.
Yes, well, there you are.
Okay to go in?
Sure, if you want to.
I want to.
Go ahead.
Ooh. Nice room.
Yes, it is. Nice room. We have tea in here.
Tea?
Yes. My mother has a friend. Well, he's my friend too, in a way, and he comes here to have tea. He was here today, as a matter of fact, just a short while ago.
To have tea?
Yes.
Then what's these?
Glasses. Today, we had whiskey.
Uh-huh. What's that up there? Over the fireplace?
Right. I think I'll have another drink right now, if you have no objection.
Needs dusting.
How's that?
How do I get up there to dust that thing?
No, you don't.
Oh, okay. Okay.
That is an oil painting. I painted it. One of these days, perhaps, I shall clean it. Do you, by any chance, like it? The painting?
The old gentleman looks dead.
Dead?
Well, that's how he looks to me.
Yes, well, actually, he is dead. That's a portrait of my father. He died a year ago. I painted the portrait right after he died. He was a famous man.
You painted him dead?
That's not so at all. As a matter of fact, the portrait is very... accurate, very lifelike. That's the way my father looked. I spent a great deal of time with my father. I painted him from memory. I didn't even have to consult a photograph. I had an indelible image in my mind. I painted from that.
I guess you thought of him being dead.
What? What did you say? That's a terrible thing you said.
It is?
I can't think why you would say a thing like that. The flesh tones, the eyes. Now listen, you just get started on your cleaning, all right? That's what you came here to do.
Sure is.
I'm going up to see how my mother is, to tell her you're here.
You go right ahead.
And don't you dare lay your hands on that painting. Do you hear me?
I hear. Sure. I hear.
She'd angered me, this total stranger who had entered the house with such assurance. She'd come there to mop the floors and polish the furniture and scrub the sink. And 5 minutes later, I was in a frenzied rage. As I headed for my mother's room, I could hear her little piping voice from the library.
What's the matter with you, old gentleman? They hang you up on the wall and you can't get down? This is where all the fun is. Don't you know that? Why do you want to stay up there so stiff and all?
I don't remember grabbing the bottle of whiskey before I left the library, but my mother was quick to notice it.
Charles!
How's your headache?
You might knock before you enter my room.
How is your head?
What is that you have in your hand?
What?
Is that a bottle?
This? Oh. Why, yes. It is a bottle.
A bottle of whiskey?
Must have picked it up in the library.
I trust you'll put it back where you found it.
She's in there now.
Who?
The maid. She is in the library.
Oh, Geraldine sent someone, did she? Who did she send? Jane? Dorothy? Or one of the cousins?
She says she's an outside girl.
An outside girl? I never heard of an outside girl.
All I know is that that's what she said.
Oh, probably mean she doesn't live in. Help used to live in when I was a girl. Had their own rooms and everything in the attic.
Well, I don't know, Mother, but I have a feeling that that's not what she meant.
Well, she ain't good.
How do I know? She just started.
Geraldine wouldn't send anyone who wasn't really good.
Hmm. She's got good taste in art. I know that much.
What on earth do you know about her taste in art?
She hates the portrait.
She said that. She said she hated it.
Said he looks dead.
She said that? Well, of all the nerve.
She's right. There's no life, no personality, no character, no mystery. There's nothing. Just a blank. Just paint on canvas. Could have been done by a computer.
Now, Chuck. Oh, dear. Answer that, will you?
Yes, if you want.
My head's still.
Hello?
This is Philip, Charles.
Oh, what do you want, Philip?
Well...
Oh, is it Philip?
Just to ask how you are, Charles.
I'm fine.
Are you sure?
Why shouldn't I be fine?
Well, you know...
No, I don't know. If I say I'm fine, Philip, I'm fine.
You don't sound fine to me.
Well, I can't help how I sound to you.
Well, let me speak to your mother, will you?
What for?
Let me speak to her, Charles.
He wants to talk to you.
Oh, well.
You're here.
Hello, Philip.
I was certain sure that Philip had called because he'd seen me take a drink in the library. And knowing me, as he did only too well and had for a long time, he wisely suspected that another drink would follow the first. Which, of course, it had.
Oh, Philip, no.
Now, as faithful family friend, he was calling my mother to tell her, to warn her. Oh, how foolish, how uncomprehending some people can be.
Philip, thank you. I'm very grateful. But what can I do?
All that misplaced kindness and solicitude. But they do not know. They simply do not know. They cannot.
Yes.
How little it is appreciated.
Yes. Do come by tomorrow. Thank you, Philip.
Before the phone touched the cradle, I was out the door and racing down the staircase. Behind me, I could hear my mother calling out to me.
Charles! Please, Charles!
I headed for the library, and just outside the door, I stopped. And from the other side, I heard that little voice.
Hey, old gentleman, you're trying to stare me down. I ain't afraid, I'm on to you. Them glassy blue eyes don't fool me, or that pink skin. Or those red lips, or those dandy clothes, neither. I know all about you, old man. All you need is one good push, and it's all over. Just one hefty shove, that's all.
Cassandra!
Yes, Mr. Dryer?
What were you doing?
I gotta collect these glasses and wash them up.
You were doing something else. Did you put your hands on it?
Oh, on the picture, you mean?
You know that's what I mean.
You told me not to.
Well, did you?
No, I was only talking to it.
Why would... What? Talking to it? Do you like the picture?
Change of question. Do I like it? I like to talk to it. One of these days, maybe he'll talk back.
That's a weird idea.
I talk to lots of things and they talk back. You can talk to anything you got a feeling for.
And you... have a feeling for this portrait, is that it?
Up to now, in this house, it's the only thing I got a feeling for.
Yeah. Oh. Why don't you get on with your work?
I'm through in here.
Leave the glasses. We'll leave one anyway.
Okay. I'll start in on the dining room.
Yes, you do that. You just do that. Father? Do you feel like talking to me by any chance? Yeah. Well, I didn't think so. Well, how about me talking to you, huh? Yes, well, that's even less attractive, right? Yes, that's what I thought. Communication is zilch. As usual, as ever, as always was and forever shall be, world without end. So be it. I'm sorry. I am sorry. Sorry. I am sorry. Whatever I did, I'm sorry. No matter what it was, I'm sorry. Even if I didn't do anything, I am sorry. Every minute of every hour of every day and all night, I am sorry. There. I'm not going to say it again. I'm sorry. You take it from there. You want me to help you?
Help me.
Father. I swear to you, I heard the words, help, help me. And in my father's voice, though it was hoarse and tremulous, still it was his. Now, you'll say it was the product of my fevered brain or the alcohol that inflamed it. I shall not dispute with you. I cannot confirm or deny anything you say. But neither could I refuse the plea that reached me from that wretched portrait. Somehow, I got to my feet and staggered toward it. I stretched out my arms to it, grasped it, and wrenched it from the wall. Holding it tightly, desperately in my arms, I fell to the floor and lay there sobbing, sobbing like a child whose heart has been broken.
Never say to anyone, it's all in your imagination. What finer place can there be than your imagination? Listen to what Joseph Conrad had to say somewhere around the beginning of the century. Only in men's imagination does every truth find an effective and undeniable existence. Imagination is the supreme master of life. I'll be back shortly with Act Three. Still surround the virulent disease of alcoholism is the pattern of the periodic alcoholic. This drinker can ignore liquor totally, and it would appear without effort for months and even years at a time. Then some tiny portion of his nervous mechanism is faulted, and he finds himself careening down a long road which he must follow to its unforeseeable dead end.
If you have never suffered a blackout, first, let me congratulate you. Then let me assure you that during a blackout, it is perfectly possible for a drinker to move about, accomplish many tasks, talk to other people in a sensible way, and have no consciousness of anything he is doing or anything that is going on around him. And when he has come to the end of the line, he will remember absolutely nothing. The amnesia is complete as though he had suffered a severe brain concussion, which perhaps he has. It is very frightening to wake and remember nothing. I recognized faintly my own room, my own bed, and finally myself. Who could be knocking at the door? The police? An angry stranger I had insulted or injured? Or could it be fate come to collect a last payment?
Charles? Charles? Are you awake? I need to talk to you.
Oh, what is it?
Oh, thank the Lord. I've been trying to rouse you all day.
What day is that?
You were drinking last night, weren't you?
I must have been.
Oh, Charles.
Please, Mother, don't start in on
me. How could you?
How couldn't I?
You were doing so well. I was so proud of you.
Mother, kindly shut up.
All right. But I've been so worried, I called Philip.
Oh, why did you do that, for God's sake?
Well, when I couldn't rouse you, I had to tell somebody, being all alone here. And by the way, that girl Geraldine sent was just no good at all.
No.
I got out of bed last night to make some dinner, and I looked all over for you, but I couldn't find you. Did you go out someplace?
Maybe I did.
You mean you're not going to tell me?
I mean, I don't know.
Oh, Charles. Oh,
wait a minute. Wait. What do you mean the girl Geraldine sent was no good?
Well, the kitchen was a mess. A perfect mess. Looked like it hadn't even been touched. There was one glass in the sink.
Just one?
Just one. And not washed properly either.
Yeah, well, I think you'll find the other one in the library.
Well, how would you know that?
I don't know it. I feel it.
Were you drinking with that girl?
I don't think I was.
You don't think?
Oh, please, Mother. I'm trying to fit the pieces together. You're not helping me.
Anyway, I heated up some soup and made some toast, and then I cleaned up the kitchen a little bit, which wasn't easy with my head throbbing the way it was, and then I went to bed. I was sure you'd come home sooner or later from wherever you were.
And the prodigal always returns.
And then this morning I waited for you to come to my room, as you usually do. Mm. Waited and waited and waited and waited and waited until finally I got up and came in here.
And here I was, all snug in my little bed.
Yes, but dead to the world.
Passed out is the proper term.
Well, I shook you and shook you. I put ice on your forehead, but I couldn't even get you to open your eyes. That's what I call Philip.
I wish you hadn't done that.
I had to do something.
I never got over the trip he made to Walla Walla that time.
Well, Philip's a very good friend.
That he is.
A very good friend indeed.
Mother, did it ever occur to you that it is those very good friends indeed that a man most wants to avoid when he's... when he's like this? That a man wants to be alone... and be left alone.
Be that as it may, Philip said he'd come right over, and he'll be here any minute.
Oh.
So I suggest you get up and shower and put on some fresh clothes.
I will.
And in the meantime, I'll make some tea.
Mm.
Maybe I'll have time to check over the rest of the downstairs and see what kind of shape that wretched girl left it in.
Okay.
Would you rather I sent Philip up here when he arrived?
No. I'll come down.
All right, then. And you pull yourself together.
The old belief that a shower and clean clothes will clear the head and invigorate the body persists in spite of all evidence to the contrary. Still, I followed the ritual of the ancient myth to the letter. Just as I finished the supposedly curative ceremony, I heard the signal of Philip's arrival. I made a feeble effort to square my shoulders, force a welcoming smile. I hid my trembling hands in my trouser pockets and started down the stairs.
So good of you, Philip. Please give me your coat.
Thank you. How is he?
Well, at least he's conscious. I suppose that's something.
That's a lot more than something.
Hello, Charles.
Hello, my friend. Good to see you. In a way.
Your mother was worried about you, so I...
Don't bother to explain. I understand perfectly. Well, maybe not perfectly, but well enough for the present.
Now, look, I'm going to go get the tea things and make some cinnamon toast. You two go into the library and have a nice talk.
All right, Mother. All right.
I won't be but a moment.
After you, good friend.
Thank you.
Ah, there's the telltale glass.
How's that?
Your mother says she found one glass in the kitchen, and just one. I remember Cassie taking one out to wash it, and I seemed to remember there had been two, and one was here.
You and I had a drink together. I shouldn't have let you, but I did try.
You couldn't have stopped me.
I should have tried harder.
Same result. I think I know what happened. After Cassie went out with the one glass...
Well, who's Cassie?
Cassandra, the maid that Geraldine sent in her place.
Oh, yes. She was at the back door when I left.
Yes. Mother says she did a rotten job, which was a big disappointment to Mother because all of Geraldine's relatives are supposed to be very good.
Which relative was this?
I never did find out because I was showing her around the house, the downstairs part, and we came in here and... she saw the portrait of Father. The first thing she said was, he looks dead. Well, of course, I said...
Charles!
Well, he is
Charles.
Dead. And then,
Charles, where is the portrait?
What? Where is it?
It's not over the fireplace.
It's not? Oh, no. No, it's not. It's not, is it?
Where is it, Charles?
I don't know. I have no idea.
Wait. Wait a minute. Wait now. After Cassie went out... Yes. Yes, now, I sat here for quite a while. I talked.
Yes, I talked to the portrait of my father.
You did?
Yes, I did. Why not? Why shouldn't I talk to my father?
Oh, there's no reason.
That's right. I talked to him.
I talked to the portrait and... And the portrait...
Yes. Well, go on, Charles. The portrait...
The portrait talked back. My father talked back.
Oh. What did he say?
He said, help. He said, help me.
That doesn't make much sense.
It did to me at the time.
You'd had a lot to drink.
To me, it made perfect sense. I got up and I walked to the fireplace. I reached out. I reached up and I took the picture down and I held it. I held it close. I think I was crying and then I fell down. I was still holding the portrait of my father and I fell down. After that, I don't remember anything at all.
And now the picture is gone.
Yeah, well, did I throw it out with the trash? I mean, did I give it away to someone on the street? Did I throw it in the river? What the hell did I do with it? What did I do with it?
Just then, my mother came in with her silly tea things, and of course we had to show her that glaringly clean space above the fireplace where the portrait had hung and hung no more. Well, you can imagine how she carried on. If it had been a Rembrandt, she couldn't have set up a bigger outcry. As for me, I couldn't have cared less about its loss. All that bothered me was what had become of it. How did it disappear?
That girl took it. That girl that Geraldine sent, she took it.
Oh, Mother, why would she take it?
Because she's a thief, that's why.
I have a feeling that the portrait is still in this house. I think you, Charles, after you took it down from the wall, I don't think you threw it out or gave it away or any of those things.
He might have.
Yes, I might have, the way I felt about it.
Well, nevertheless, I don't think you did. Now, let's just assume for the moment that I'm right. That it is still in the house, so let's go look for it. All right?
All right, Philip. If you say so.
All right, Charles?
No, I'm not going to look for it.
Oh, Charles. The very least...
No. It's all right, Your mother and I will look for it. You stay here.
You answer the phone, Charles. Least you can do that. That's the very least you can do.
Hello?
Hey, hello, Mr. Dreyer. Is that you?
Who's this?
This is Geraldine, Mr. Dreyer.
Oh, yes, Geraldine.
Could I speak with your mother, please?
Not right now, Geraldine. She's otherwise engaged, and I'm not sure this is a good time for you to talk to her anyway. She's pretty upset about that girl you sent yesterday.
That's what I'm calling about, Mr. Dreyer. I forgot to send anybody. My mother took a turn for the worse and a clean forgot.
You didn't send anyone?
I'm sorry.
Then who was the girl who showed up?
Somebody showed up? Why, I didn't send anybody.
Said her name was Cassandra.
Don't know nobody by that name. Who did she say she was?
Well, she said she was an outside girl. Whatever that means.
Oh, Mr. Dreyer, that just means she's not one of the family. She's not related. Oh, I'd never send you an outside girl, never.
I see. Well, thanks for calling, Geraldine.
Well, the portrait is nowhere on this floor. I'm going to have some tea, and then I'll look upstairs.
I have it! I have it!
Oh, Philip found it! Oh, Philip!
I had a feeling. I had an instinct that told me that...
Well, where was it?
It was in the studio on the third floor.
Well, how in the world did it get up?
Well, I'm going to show it to you, but I want to warn you. You may be in for a bit of a shock.
You mean something's... I did something to it, mutilated it or something?
You did something to it, Charles, but you didn't mutilate it. You humanized it. Look, it's the portrait of a man. A real man. A little vain. A little pompous. A little afraid to love. A great desire to love and be loved. It's
really a very good portrait, Charles. Of your father.
So that was what my father had meant when he said, help me. He meant, let me be what I am. And somehow, in my muddled state, I had dragged the foolish pretense of a portrait up to the studio and painted it over. I'll never paint another picture or take another drink. I am content to leave things as they are. My father and I are friends now. I know him, and he knows me. His warts and mine are all there for the world to see. Or at least I can see his and he can see mine. Oh, I don't think I'll ever tell my mother about Cassandra. I wouldn't know how, and it would only confuse her. I myself am not positive she was ever there.
Every boy child ever born, his father is a giant, a colossus, very near to being a god. Inexorably, as the boy child grows, he discovers that omnipotence does not reside in the man he worshipped, nor infinite wisdom, nor unfailing goodness. This discovery can be a trauma that cripples him for the rest of his life, and he may never know it. I'll be back shortly. If I could have my way, I would whisper into the ear of every small boy that the big man he has deified is as human as he is. That when he grows up and becomes a father himself, his small son will worship him in the same way and eventually be just as disillusioned. But what small boy would listen or believe? Our cast included Paul Hecht, Ann Petoniak, Ralph Bell, and Catherine Byers. The entire production was under the direction of Hyman Brown. And now, a preview of our next tale.
I feel a weight, as if something kneels on my chest. A pressure, a terrible pressure. My neck is being squeezed and squeezed as something seems to be draining the breath from my body. Not only the breath, but the strength. Everything is being drawn from me. I want to struggle, but I can't move. I want to shout for help, but I can't utter a word. I try to fight, to resist, but I'm paralyzed and powerless. And then suddenly, in perspiration, trembling, and then, exhausted, I fall asleep and slumber restlessly till morning.
This is E.G. Marshall inviting you to return to our Mystery Theater for another adventure in the macabre. Until next time, pleasant dreams.